Okay, so it's a pleasure to be here. I want to thank all the organizers of this very nice conference. What I'll talk about is a topic which is very active in recent years, recent decade, world maps. I'll give all the definitions, and I think, maybe half of the talk will be dedicated to some background for those of you who are not familiar with the subject, and half for some from some new results. So the contents of the talk is as above. We'll first say something about where in classical problem in number theory and non-commutative analogs of it, mainly for finite simple groups. Then we will deal with words and probability to study word maps from a probabilistic point of view. And then we will focus on some results, on more recent results on Lie groups, connections between word maps and various Lie groups. And the latest chapter is related to linear groups and to a new concept of probabilistic identities. There will be also many conjectures, so you will get homework and exercises. I mentioned the classical Waring problem. It is actually interesting that, you know, the topic of approximate sum groups is very active nowadays, with also people here and elsewhere. And the motivation came from additive number theory. So also what I'm going to say, at least my original motivation came from additive number theory, and this is the Waring problem. So everything starts with this result of Lagrange, that every positive integer is a sum of four squares. And Waring asked whether it's true, whether you can generalize it vastly and say that every natural number is a sum of gk kth powers for a suitable function g. Actually, he didn't formulate it in this way. Maybe he wrote something on the margins of I know that Fermat did it, but what he did say, he said something like this. He said, it wasn't a question, it was a declaration, and he said that and every natural number is a sum of 9 cubes and the 19th fourth powers, etc. So the etc. became the Waring problem. And indeed, his prediction was correct. So G3 is 9, G4 is 19, exactly as he predicted. Hilbert was the first to solve the problem affirmatively. Then Hardy and Littlewood did work on this with the circle method. What we are interested in non-commutative analogs. So what does it mean? First of all, we are working now in groups, not in rings. So we just have one operation, the group multiplication, and we can ask similar questions about powers in groups. For example, to present every element as a sum of few squares, or we can ask questions on commutators, and in general, we can study words in groups. Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. So to understand the notion of a word is just an element of the free group, let's say, of rank D on a generating set X1 to XD. And what we want to define is the central notion of the talk, the notion of a word map. So a word map is... what happened? Okay, so a world map is a function from G to the D to G, which is obtained by substituting group elements instead of the variables, okay? So it's not a group homomorphism, of course, it's quite complicated. And the image of the world map, we denoted by WG. In general, WG to the K, or a set to the K, we mean all products of length K of elements from this subset. So WG to the K is just a product of K word values, if you like. Okay, so this is a notation. And let's start with a theorem of Borel. So Borel proved in 83 that world maps are dominant on simple algebraic groups. Okay, so this is a very important theorem for us. It is an important tool in many of the results. So it means that, you know, the image of the world map is large. It's open dense. It's not contained in a proper subvariety. This is quite useful. It's particularly useful when you switch from algebraic groups to finite simple groups of Lie type. And indeed, for some time now, we'll be interested in finite simple groups. And we assume the classification, of course. And John Wilson proved in 94, he studied the commutator world map. So this is a simple group commutator. You see, maybe it would have been better without a pointer, but anyway. So what he proved is that there is some absolute constant C such that in every finite simple group, non-abelian of course, every element is a product of C commutators. Okay, so this is one of the origins of its result of the type we are interested to present group elements as short products of word values. He actually used some mathematical logic in his proof, so C was unspecified. Later on, and probably many of you know this, we will see that actually C is one. So so every element of a finite simple group is a commutator. We will reach this later. We also have a result of Martinez-Zelmanov and Saxel-Wilson independently, essentially at the same time, who deals with powers. Powers are the main object of the Waring problem, so it's interesting to study them in this context. If we take the world map X to the K, then for a finite simple group, either WG is one, namely for all elements X to the K is one, it can happen of course, or if it's not always one, then there is some bounded product giving you the whole of G. And the exponent depends on K, it's some large function f of K. So this is what they proved. And we are interested, of course, in extension to general words. So with Liebeck, we proved that any word W, for any word W, there exists a constant depending on the word, such that for any finite simple group, either WG is one, or WG to this constant is the whole of G. So it's exactly like the results of Wilson Martinez-Zelmanov, Saxel-Wilson, but not just for power and commutators, but for general word. You can complain about DC, maybe it's it doesn't depend on the word, and actually only quite recently there were works proving that it does depend. And Kasabov and Nikolov gave some examples, and Alex Lubotsky gave a nice characterization, what can be the image of a word map. And all these results show that CW genuinely depends on W, so it may go to infinity. It is not absolutely bounded. Was a little surprise that for large G, CW does not depend on W and is actually very small. Okay, so the first result of this type is from something I proved in 2009, that for any word, non-trivial word W, there exists a constant depending on W, such that WG cube is G for any finite simple group whose order is at least this constant, N of W. Okay, so so if the finite simple group is large enough, then every element, and the word is given, then every element is a product of three word values. The proof used the probabilistic method, character method, also the theorem of Borel on the dominance of word maps. There was a new proof by Nikolov and Piber a bit later using Gower's trick and quasi-random groups. This result was improved, so in a joint work with Larsen and Tiep, we showed the following, that we reduced the 3 to 2. So instead of WG cube, we have WG square. So every element of a finite simple group is a product of two word values if the finite simple group is sufficiently large. It's quite a long and complicated proof using algebraic geometry, representation theory, probabilistic ideas. Let me just demonstrate this in the context of powers, because in Waring problem, you know, we studied powers, so what happens with powers? So again, in every finite simple group, if it's large enough, given k, then every element of it is a product of 2kth powers. So you see, so just a minute ago, we had a product of fk kth powers, and now the fk became 2, so it's quite nice. So we see already that in some way there are better solutions to Waring type problems in the non-commutative world. Also, of course, the sums needed in number theory are unbounded, sum of kth powers, but the sums here are of the products here are of length 2, which is quite surprising. Now you can say, well, but maybe even 2 can be reduced to 1. Namely, WG is G, that the word is surjective on finite simple groups. But this need not happen. So let me now tell you something about surjective words. So surjective words are word maps which are onto every finite simple group, so maybe every, or almost every in some times. So for example, x squared is never surjective because it's never injective, because finite simple groups contain an involution. So this is the easiest example of a map which is not surjective. So it also shows that the previous theorem I showed you is in a way best possible. But what can we say? Maybe some words are surjective. So which words are surjective on all finite simple groups? A very old conjecture of Ore from 1951 dealt with the commutator word. So he conjectured that the commutator word is surjective on all finite simple groups, so that every element of every finite simple group is a commutator. Many people contributed to trying to prove Ore conjecture. Ore himself proved it for the alternating group, but actually his proof, if you read it, shows that in the alternating group, every element is a commutator of two permutations in the symmetric group, and which is easier to show. But then he says that a little bit more technical argument shows it for alternating groups. But it's not a big deal. I mean, it is true for alternating groups, many people contributed also. Ehlers Gordeev proved an important theorem, and eventually we proved with Liebeck, O'Brien, and Tiep that Ore conjecture holds in general. Now, the commutator map is just one map. There is historical interest in it, but what about other surjective words? So, again, the same group of people, but also independently, in a different paper by Guralnik and Malle, it was proved that every element of every finite simple group is a product of two p-th powers for any prime p. Okay, so for example, if we focus for a minute on p equals 2, then every element of every finite simple group is a product of two squares. So if you like, this can be regarded as a non-commutative analog of Lagrange four squares theorem, but now we just need two. Note that it doesn't follow from the general theorem that WG square is G. Why? Do you see why it doesn't follow? I start to ask you questions so you don't fall asleep. So the group should be large in order for WG square to be G, okay? So, and we want something which is surjective on all without a single exception. So you cannot use this theorem. And it's a kind of a miracle that there is no single exception in Ori conjecture, in the two square theorem like this. It's one of the, there are various miraculous properties of finite simple groups, and maybe this is one of them. Anyway, let me move on and give you, this was more like history, give you a brand new result. So I'll discuss two results whose proof was just completed for this conference. And they are related in a way to classical theorems of Bernside and Fay Thompson. So it's joint work with Guralnik, Liebeck, O'Brien, and Tiep. So the first result is that if pq are primes and ab are natural numbers and n is p to the a times q to the b, namely it's a natural number with at most two prime divisors, then x to the n, y to the n is surjective on all finite simple groups. So first of all, it extends the case of p. We said that x to the p, y to the p is surjective, and this is extension. It's also best possible in the sense that you cannot replace the condition of two prime divisors by three, because, for example, A5, just three prime divisors of its order. So x to the 60 is identically 1, so also x to the 60, y to the 60 will be identically 1, so it's trivially false. And if you like, it, of course, it implies Bernside's p to the a, q to the b theorem. So this is a theorem saying that groups of order p to the a, q to the b are always solvable. So trivially, it implies this. The reason is here. And now let me move to a deeper theorem of the odd order theorem of Fay and Thompson.
Here's a question for you.
Yeah.
Can A or B be zero? Let's work for just the prime power.
Yeah, B can be zero. Yeah. It's also true for prime power. You see, I also didn't say that P is different from Q, so you can also take P equals Q.
No, you said primes.
Ah, you are right. So 5 and 5 are not primes.
But if you have 3 primes, maybe it's true for big enough simple groups.
For big enough simple groups, it's true for any n because of the general result that WG square is G if G is large. But we want things without a single exception. This is the difference.
But Aner, you can rectify by deleting the S from primes, then the word prime becomes an adjective which you can apply to one or two.
Oh, I see. So it's a good English without the S? Okay, I trust you.
Thank God for this dictionary.
Okay, so let me see. Another result of this type, which in a way could be looked as an extension of the odd order theorem, is the following, that if n is any odd integer, then x to the n, y to the n, z to the n is surjective on all finite simple groups. You may complain that Here it's a product of length 3, and here we just had 2, but it cannot be 2 in this case. We have examples, for example, some groups of type PSL2Q show that this is not, or x to the n, y to the n for n odd is not always surjective, so we cannot reduce the length of this product. Now let me tell you something about ideas involved in the proof of this result. Long, horrible proof, as you see, it's like 80 pages or something. But the strategy, I simplify it a bit, is not too hard to grasp. So let's say it's an induction on the rank. The rank of alternating group is its degree, and the rank of group of Lie type is the Lie rank. And so there are various base case calculations, like you have to consider some very big groups, so sometimes you use computers and computational group theory for the base cases. And the induction step is, inductive step goes like this, that if little g lies in a product of simple subgroups of smaller rank, then by induction, you know, these simple subgroups of smaller rank satisfy the induction hypothesis, so the thing which should be surjective is surjective on them, and because g lies in product of them, everything is okay. And therefore, it's enough to consider the case where this does not hold, okay? And then, I'm cheating a little bit, but otherwise it will be very technical. So if it does not hold, we say that such an element is unbreakable if it doesn't lie in a product like this. And unbreakable element, we prove that they have very large centralizer. So very small centralizer, and so very large conjugacy class. And once you have element with very small centralizer, character methods are usually useful because the character values of such an element will be small. So we then use character methods to prove what we want. For example, if we want to prove that g is x to the n, y to the n, like in the extension of Bernside, So then we can try to pick conjugacy classes C1 and C2 in G of nth powers, and to show that this G lies in the product of the conjugacy classes. And then it is a result of Frobenius, I think, even not from the 20th century, from the late 19th century, says that G is inside the product of two classes, if and only if this character expression is non-zero. So you sum up over all irreducible characters, and this should be non-zero. Now, the fact that G is a very small centralizer can be used to show that this is very small or fairly small, and then you can hope to get control of the sum. Okay, so this is the idea of the proof. And here is a conjecture, surjectivity conjecture, which is still open, and there is a lot of evidence using computers, etc., some theoretical result, but we're still far from a solution, so I give you a challenge. Take an angle word, so like repeated commutator. Then the conjecture is that every angle word is surjective on every finite simple group. So, of course, this would generalize or a conjecture. Also, you don't. Also, for sufficiently large, it's unknown. The thing with this conjecture is that also philosophically, you know that there is a theorem of. Of Zorn, actually, I think that if you have a finite group satisfying an angle identity where this is always 1, then it's nilpotent. Now, finite simple groups, non-abelian, are the opposite of nilpotent groups in a way, so for this we want, and the opposite of the fact that this is always 1 is that this is actually surjective, so you kind of, if you want philosophically, and there is very compelling evidence, I'm really sure it's true, but it's still a challenge. Okay, now let me say some quick things about words and probability, because it's more part of the background. than the new results. So, but there are probabilistic aspects of all these. So, for example, you can consider a random walk where WG, the image of the world map, is a generating set. Okay, and you don't even take inverses. You don't need to take inverses. So here it's some formalities defining the distributions. But essentially, you take the Cayley graph of the group, and you take k-step random walk with WG as a generating set, and you want to study the mixing time. And the mixing time turns out to be 2. Okay, so formally, if you take the L1 norm of this convolution and the distance between this convolution and the uniform distribution on G, this goes to 0. As G is a finite simple group of increasing order, so the mixing time is actually 2. This was proved with Larsen in the case of alternating groups and with my student Gilly Schul in the case of groups of Lie type. But there is another distribution which is of interest, maybe more natural. So let's define PWG to be the probability. It actually measures the size of the fibers of the world map normalized, so it's a probability distribution. So if you let G1 to GD distribute uniformly and independently over G, then what is the probability that the value will be a given G in G? So this probability is denoted by PW, capital G, little g. So what are the questions here? We hope actually that this probability will be quite small, and the question is how small they are. So here are some results with Dixon, Piber, and Sheresh. We show already a while ago that PWG1 goes to 0 as the order of G goes to infinity. So think of it, what does it mean? The probability to get the value 1 if you substitute random elements in a word, the probability to get 1 becomes smaller and smaller as the group order becomes larger and larger. And this, we had motivation, it solves, it gives a probabilistic solution to a problem by Magnus, which was earlier solved by Weigel. But this is a much shorter proof and with a new concept. But anyway, we didn't have any good bounds on PWG. And in later theorem with Larsen, we proved a bound which is fairly strong. So the bound is the order of G to the minus epsilon, where epsilon depends on the word W. Okay, of course, ideally, if epsilon was 1, then this would be g to the minus 1, and everything would be uniform, and this would be great. But it's not true for all words, and actually, this epsilon genuinely depends on the word. For example, for the power map x to the k, we can show that epsilon is roughly 1 over k, and it can go to 0 with the word. And this had some application to subgroup growth and to representation varieties. I should go faster.
G is 1 is the worst case?
Pardon?
G is 1, the maximum.
There is a conjecture like this in some context, but in very few cases we can prove it. But it's a good question, yeah. There is also, for some words are nice in the way that the distribution is almost uniform, in the sense that it tends to the uniform distribution as the order of the group tends to infinity. For example, the commutator word is almost uniform, and recently we proved that this is almost uniform. And actually the main goal, and we already did quite a bit to here is to show that if W1, W2 are words in disjoint variables, then the product is also almost uniform. Okay? But let me move quickly to infinite groups now. Okay, so till now we discussed finite simple groups. And now I want to say something about infinite groups, so all kinds of Lie groups, if you like. So first of all, consider p-adic groups. So if you take a semi-simple p-adic group, G, Z, P, then you can ask similar questions. And with Nir Avni, Tzachi Glander, Martin Kasabov, we proved that W of the p-adic group cube is a whole p-adic group, okay? So it's not as good because in the previous theorem for finite simple groups we had two here, but actually it is the reality. So this result is not true for if you take square here, it's only true for cubes. And also the condition that P is large, you see the condition here that P is large given the word W, it is necessary because otherwise you can divide by some congruent subgroup, get GFP as a quotient, and W of GFP could be identically one, for example, if P is small. So P should be large given W. So given these necessary conditions, we get what we want. Again, you can ask about of course, this is a kind of, the proof uses some kinds of Hensel lemma. So the first layer is kind of finite simple, but then you have go deeper and deeper. Let me pose a conjecture or a conjecture for p-adic group. So unless in trivial cases where this group SLN ZP is not perfect even, so the commutator is a proper subgroup, so if we exclude these cases listed here, then every element of SLN ZP is a commutator. So this we don't know in general. We do know this particular case if N is a proper divisor of P minus 1, then every element of PSLN ZP is a commutator. So, we can also say something about the measure, the Haar measure of the set of commutators here, but the general conjecture is still open. In a later work by Chin Yun Hui and Larsen and myself, we discussed if you like groups over p-adic fields or something which contain p-adic field or real field, and what we proved is that the square of WG is already G if there is a trivial center. So previously we had cube, but in this case, which is over a field, so fields are better behaved in many ways, we get square. And actually, we also have a result about compact real Lie groups. And again, WG square is G, but here there is a condition that the rank of the Lie group should be large. Okay, so for every word, non-trivial word, there exists N depending on the word, such that if G is a classical, connected, real, compact Lie group of rank at least N, then WG square is G. So now the groups, the relevant groups here are unitary, orthogonal, symplectic, and the spin group. And the assumption that the rank of G is large is necessary because of a result of Andreas Thom, and also I think it was proved independently but not published by Elon Lindenstrauss, that you can choose words which force you to go very close to the identity in such compact groups. And therefore WG square, if you don't say large rank, WG square can be also very close to the identity, and even WG to the K need not be the whole of G. So it's it's a necessary condition in the previous theorem. Let me remind you just for a minute, the previous theorem, this one, that the rank is large. Okay. Okay, now I'm reaching the last chapter of the talk. What I would like to discuss is, first of all, the notion of probabilistic identity. And we also pass here from, you see, we started with finite simple groups and then Lie groups, and now we want to be able to say something about linear groups in general. But let me first define a probabilistic identity. So W is a non-trivial word. G now is a residually finite group. So we think of infinite groups now. And we say that W is a probabilistic identity of G if there is epsilon, positive epsilon, such that for each finite quotient of G, the probability to get one is at least epsilon. Okay, so the fiber above one in this finite quotient is fairly big. So this is a definition, and you can also formulate it in terms of profinite groups. So profinite completion has a normalized Haar measure, and then you want that the probability, that this probability with respect to the normalized Haar measure will be positive. Let me give you, so this is a weakening of the notion of identity. Identity, when something is trivially, is always one under all substitutions. And now it should be one with positive probability. Okay, let me give you some examples. So one example is the word X square is a probabilistic identity of the infinite dihedral group D infinity. It's you know, you have a cyclic subgroup, and all elements outside it are involutions. So, or you can also move to the completion and see that PW G hat 1 is 1/2. So this is maybe the first example which comes to mind, but it also shows you that it's a fairly tricky, because the fact that you have many involutions, many elements satisfying X square is one, doesn't mean that all the elements satisfy this or something similar to this. In general, you can generalize this example and talk about the notion of coset identity. So you see, a coset identity is a non-trivial word such that this is always one where K is a finite index subgroup, and these are some prescribed cosets of the finite index subgroup. Okay, so again, we don't insist that it will be always one for all substitutions, but if we pick particular cosets of a finite index subgroup, then we want it to be one. So for example, you see that this is a coset identity, because if we take the non-trivial coset of the cyclic subgroup, then X square will be always one in this coset, and this is just generalizing. So of course, any coset identity is a probabilistic identity, because you know in the completion, the measure of this will be positive. Okay, so the main result in now that I want to discuss is the proof is not even written up yet. A very recent result with Michael Larsen, which says the following. So if G is a finitely generated linear group, then G satisfies a probabilistic identity if and only if G is virtually solvable. Okay, so and the proof combines strong approximation and new upper bounds for this probability, which we discussed earlier. See, previously we discussed this probability where H was a finite simple group, but now we need to discuss quotients of linear groups which need to be finite simple. They have more complicated structure, but some structure under control. And for them, we want to generalize our upper bounds on the probabilities. So this is basically, or very roughly, the idea. Now, of course, a corollary of this is that if you have a finitely generated linear group which satisfies a probabilistic identity, then it satisfies an identity. Because, of course, virtually solvable groups satisfy an identity. So this is nice. We defined a weaker concept of probabilistic identity, and at least in the realm of finitely generated linear group, it's actually equivalent to having an identity. The identity may be much more complicated. It doesn't have to be the original coset identity, much longer, etc., but at least we have this. Okay, now it is quite intriguing whether this can be generalized. The proof is sufficiently complicated even in the linear case, but let's be ambitious and think, what about nonlinear cases? And so we pose a provocative conjecture. A finitely generated residually finite group which satisfies a probabilistic identity satisfies an identity. Now, I'm not absolutely sure I believe this, but I prefer to formulate it as a conjecture, because maybe it is more attractive this way than a question. I certainly think that it is extremely hard if it's true, and maybe a better advice is to look for counterexamples.
Harder if it's not true.
Yeah. Yeah, if it's not true, it is very hard to prove it. But if you like, look for counterexamples, and maybe there are even counterexamples in the literature in some way or another. But who knows? Maybe it is true. Let me give you some evidence. Why the evidence is preliminary. So a preliminary evidence is that we have a result of Peter Neumann that if the commutator is a probabilistic identity for a finite group, then the group is bounded by abelian by bounded. In terms of epsilon, you see that it means that if x, y commute with probability at least epsilon, then the group is an extension of a group of bounded size by an abelian group, by another group of bounded size. And of course, bounded by abelian by bounded implies an identity. So this is one. So we have an identity in such a case. And in Mann, Avinoam Mann, proved the same for x squared using Neumann result and other tools. So the conjecture holds for these very simple identities of words, the commutator word and the square word. It's not enough evidence. A harder, deeper result is by Huchro in the 90s, I think, that a finitely generated propy group with a coset identity x to the p. So I don't want just coset identity, but I want x to the p to be a coset identity. So there is an open coset consisting of elements of order p. Okay, it's virtually nilpotent. Okay, such a group must be virtually nilpotent. Hence, it satisfies an identity. So this is also in the direction of the conjecture. And let me tell you something about consequences of the conjecture. First of all, so it of course implies that a coset identity implies an identity, because a coset identity implies a probabilistic identity. And this in itself is a very challenging question, also in the realm of propy groups, for example. And there is also, if true, then the conjecture will imply a nice result about residual property of free groups. So if X is a set of finite degenerated P groups, then the free group of rank D is residually X, if and only if the group is in X do not satisfy a common identity. Okay, now It is, of course, necessary condition. If you want if the free group to be residually X, you cannot have a common identity for the elements, for the groups in X. But usually it's not sufficient just to say that you don't have a common identity. There is no reason to expect that the free group will be residually in this family. But if the conjecture is true, then there is a good reason to believe it actually follows. And you can see it in a way, to say that it's residually X is saying that any non-trivial word, anyway, it's, let me formulate it like this. This follows using the fact that there is a positive probability to generate a P group because of Frattini. Everything is modulo the Frattini, and actually there is a whole class of positively finitely generated groups which becomes relevant here if the conjecture is true. So if the conjecture is true, it will have all kinds of application to residual properties, not just about P groups, but also those who know what positively finitely generated groups can connect the two notions and get all kinds of consequences. Okay, so we started with finite simple groups, and we moved to infinite groups, Lie groups, linear groups, and I see now we are back to finite groups, but now finite P groups, so I think it's enough, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Questions, comments?
Yeah. How can this method be used to prove that every finitely generated angle group is nilpotent? Or if it's true?
Well, it is believed that it's not true, and Ilya Rips is a expert here, so maybe you should talk to him.
More questions? Your last chance. Okay.
So if not, let's take another one.